good afternoon, everyone. I'm pleased to welcome you to a seminar with Professor Aly Mbaye. Professor Mbaye will speak about, can Africa compete against China in manufacturing? Let me briefly introduce our featured speaker of today. Aly Mbaye is a senior fellow of ZEF affiliated and a collaborator, a dear collaborator with our institute since a couple of years. He is a professor and was dean for a long time of the University Cheikh Anta Diop in Dakar, Senegal. He got his doctorate degree from University of Clermont-Ferrand in France. He has been a Fulbright Professor at the well-known Swarthmore College. Ali, I was only briefly teaching there. I never had such a title. It's a beautiful campus, isn't it?
Yeah, it is.
At George Washington University, Cornell, visiting professor, consultant to World Bank, lots of UN agencies. And most important, I think, in relation to us, is your leadership of the climate change economics program in Dakar under the Vascal program, which is tremendously successful, thanks to your leadership. Aly came yesterday to Bonn from a conference in Brussels on the future of the relationships between Africa and Europe. Today we are into Africa and China, but when you come next time, Aly, pick that other topic.
Sure.
We are excited. Thank you for coming. You have the floor.
Thank you.
Please.
Thank you very much, Joachim. And I would like first to thank Joachim and Christian for inviting me for this talk and express all my satisfaction to be here and interacting with you. Today I'm talking to you about the relationship between Africa and China. As you might know, China's presence is increasing tremendously in Africa. And this is being controversial. Some people believe that China is stealing jobs in Africa. Some other people believe that China is bringing wealth through investment and trade in Africa. So we wanted to investigate this. But more importantly, we have diverging economic trends between Africa and China. As you might know, Africa has been experiencing important and sustained growth. Africa has been growing more than the world average for a sustained period of time, 10 to 15 years. This has never happened in the past. On the other hand, China is having trouble in sustaining its competitivity in world market. In recent years, wages in China have increased more than productivity. So the question emerged, is Africa is going to take over from China in manufacturing? And what we consider here is traditional manufacturing. This type of sector is very unskilled labor intensive. And also, it has been the gateway for most nations to enter wealth and prosperity. In Europe, in America, in Asia, most currently developed in emerging countries started by building a comparative advantage in this light manufacturing sector, which is clothing, footwear, and the like. And China has been building its industrial strategy on that. Okay, and for a very long period of time, they have succeeded to keep the productivity grows much higher than the wage grows. But for the first time, we are observing the reverse. So are these two conflicting trends going to ultimately make Africa take over and be the next tiger of the world? Or are we going to observe the reverse? If it has to happen, what should we do to make it happen? That is the main point of my presentation. These are the points I'm going to cover. China's development strategy, export-led growth in labor-intensive manufacturing. And then we talk about China-Africa trade in manufacturing. We'll then talk about our indicator of competitiveness, which is the relative unit labor cost. And then we'll show you our indices of relative unit labor cost between different African countries and China. We'll consider the other aspect of business environment. We'll also look at some alternatives, some possible alternatives to manufacturing in Africa to create jobs and build competitiveness in Africa, and in particular, looking at the agricultural sector and mainly horticulture. So if we look at the experience of China and other East Asian countries, we'll see that they have very early, I mean, from the onset of their industrial strategy, they have sought to enter into the globalization. They wanted to integrate the world market. It has been a very clear strategy. While at the same time, Africa was hesitating. We have had huge debate in Africa whether we should or not enter the global market. Many people in my university was pioneering this idea and this position, especially with our colleague Samir Amin, who was teaching in our university. He has written extensively with other authors about this. This is a well-known infant industry argument. The idea was that African industries were too small to be successfully competitive in the world market. So we should protect them from external competition to build them up before opening our countries to competition. Asian countries made the opposite choice. They took the risk to integrate the world market. And this has been rewarding, as we will see. Here is the share of Sub-Saharan Africa and China in the compared share of Sub-Saharan Africa and China in some indicators. The first indicator is the share of world manufacturing exports. You can see that at the beginning, in 1983, it was quite close. But then look what is happening. This is China, this is Sub-Saharan Africa. Okay? And I can tell you, in 1990, Chinese GDP per capita made up only 80% of the one of Senegal. And in 2000, it increased to 538%. Okay? A dramatic shift. Now, if you look at here, you have per capita GDP in 2005 US dollar. And China is still in blue, and Sub-Saharan Africa in red. And look at what is happening. Okay? So it means, it illustrates what I said earlier, that the strategy of integrating the world market was much more rewarding than the strategy of just trying to be protected against foreign competitions. And what is also happening is that we have a completely changing structure in exports from China and from Africa. Africa has kept exporting primary products. mining, agricultural project, and the like, commodities, where China has completely modified the structure of its export, as we will see, okay, with exports being more and more skill intensive. What is desirable in the light manufacturing sector is that the potential of job creation is huge, as experience shows. It's much larger than what we observe in other sectors, mainly agriculture and services. Also, the potential of creation and diffusion of innovation is also higher. Okay? But we have some constraints. The constraints deals with quality and efficiency. You have a lot of standards and norms in this, like in agriculture. Okay? And as I mentioned to you, the potential to absorb and to disseminate innovation is bigger in this sector. Now we look at the composition of exports, comparing still China and Africa. Africa is still in blue, China is still in blue, and Africa in, no, this is China, okay? China exports and China imports. China exports in blue, and China imports in red. What you can see is here. This is the share of primary products. It has been kept very, very low. Okay, China is exporting a tiny share of primary product. It has decreased from the two sub-periods. While the imports of primary products are booming, and these imports are mainly from sub-Saharan Africa. But now let's look at what is happening in sub-Saharan Africa in two sub-periods. Okay? Most countries are overwhelmingly exporting primary products, mining, agricultural products, and the like. We have some outliers here. This is South Africa, and we have here Kenya, to a later extent. But apart from that, most countries are overwhelmingly exporting commodities, and this hasn't changed over time. Despite the high growth rate we have achieved recently. Now let's look at the exports of unskilled labor intensive products. Okay? This is China exports and China imports. Okay? China is literally no longer importing no unskilled labor intensive product like clothing. Okay? And the export is important, but it's declining over time. Okay? And if you look at what is happening on the other side, sub-Saharan Africa, the share of this kind of product is tiny. It's ridiculous. We now turn to human capital intensive products. This is the share of human capital intensive products in China import and exports. What you can see is that imports is decreasing, while exports of human capital intensive product has increased. Okay? And if you look at sub-Saharan Africa, we have in the two subsequent periods an increase in export, but it's still small in magnitudes. Now, intensive, technology intensive products. Okay? China exports and China imports. The imports small and decreasing, the export larger and increasing. If you look at Africa, we have the opposite. For many countries, we have the imports of such a product increasing over time, while the export didn't follow, okay, according to the problems in our sample. We have tried to explain these patterns in trade, imports and exports. And the indicator we're using in relative unit labor cost. This is a real exchange rate indicator.
But it is very relevant when you want to compare competition between two countries in said markets. You can usually, most real exchange rate indices assume that countries in the sample are partners and competitors at the same time. But the case can arise where two countries compete on a certain market. Okay? And this indicator is particularly relevant to this situation. I don't know the background. Is it mostly dominated by economists or?
A mix. Maybe half.
Okay. So I lost.
Well, I think we follow.
Okay. So, roughly, what this indicator, the story the indicators tell us, is that if you want to be competitive against other countries, you have to control three elements. The first element is productivity. Here is the reverse of productivity. And when we put a star here, it means that it's a foreign country. Here would be, for example, Senegal and China. You need to look at your wage and to look at your counterpart's wage. And you have to look at your exchange rate and against your counterpart. If you combine these three variables, you have a relative unit labor cost. Relative unit labor cost is the ratio of, for example, one African country's labor cost to another's. Okay? And as I mentioned to you, this is an indicator that is deemed robust by an important body of literature in economics. It's what I meant. We have these three elements: relative productivity, relative wages, real wages, and relative exchange rate relative to PPP, purchasing power parity exchange rate. So if you want to be competitive against your counterpart, you need to control for this, I mentioned to you, real wage, real productivity, and the exchange rate. And if the ratio, the bilateral ratio, is inferior to one, it means that you are, for this item, for this product, you're more competitive than the other country. And this is the framework we have used. These are the data we have used about wages and productivity. We have used UNUDO data, supplemented by data from national sources in China and Senegal. We have used these two series of PPP data, and these are our price data. I will not insist on that. And what we realize is that if you look at this indicator, Africa's performance is improving, but not to the point where it can threaten China. This is, in a nutshell, what I was going to show. Okay? What we have here is level of wages in dollar. Okay? And what we can see is that among all these countries in our sample, South Africa has the greatest level of wages in dollar. And you can guess who follows? Almost my country, Senegal. Okay? It's lower than Morocco and Tunisia and some other countries. But if you look at the ratio to capital GDP, you see that it's very high. I mean, salary in dollar reported to per capita GDP is 7.8% in Senegal, 6.3% in Ethiopia, 5.3% in Cameroon. But look at what is happening in Asia countries. It's small and well controlled. Okay? And this is a problem. And we compare it in two sub-periods. Okay? It's still high in Senegal if you look at this as compared to what is happening in other countries. Okay, this is a problem. It means that in terms of the first element of comparison, that is real wages, we have also a long way, we still have a long way to go. Now, let's look at productivity, labor productivity. Okay? We are comparing productivity to the US level. Okay? We can see that in terms of the US, for example, Ethiopia's level of productivity is only 3% the one in the US. Why? For where it is once it's 0.02. Okay? So here is when we divide both, we have in the buffers. Okay? What is important is the difference between productivity and wage. Okay? Productivity is still superior to wage. And we can see the consequence. Ethiopia can expand and is dramatically expanding its exports. But when you look at other countries, it's not the case. Okay? And while if you look at Asian countries, this is the case for Bangladesh, this is the case for China, okay? This is the case for India, etc. They are performing much better in terms of this indicator. Okay? And now we're looking at the three elements at the same time: productivity, wage, and the real exchange rate appreciation. Okay? And China's currency is appreciating. Okay? You can see that productivity growth is lower than wage growth. Okay, which is a problem. And now China is trying to outsource its company in Africa. They have succeeded to outsource some of their companies in Ethiopia, for example, in the leather sector. And they have been trying to do it in Rwanda, in Niger, in Nigeria, in Senegal, but without much success. So they are aware that their competitiveness is getting eroded, and they're trying to do something. And what we realize is that other Asian countries are taking over instead of African countries. Okay, what is happening in Ethiopia is fantastic. The productivity increase is small, but they bring down their wages, so it's fine. Okay, Kenya likely. Mauritius is having so the same productivity, higher than wages in Senegal, South Africa, and Tanzania. And it's what we have put in a chart. These are the unit labor costs, the relative unit labor cost of these countries related to China. We can see that it is decreasing. It means that we are gaining competitiveness against China. But for most countries, this is the threshold level. Until the index is below one, we don't have competitiveness against China. So this is a problem. We have some countries like Tanzania and Ethiopia, which are exceptions. But for most countries, even though we are observing a declining trend, this is not enough to bring any significant competitivity gains against China. This is, to us, why we are struggling to take over from China. Our costs are not enough small to attract a foreign direct investment, either from China or from other sources from the world in the traditional sectors, but because we want to be competitive. Let me add that our indicator, the relative unit labor cost, captures the cost of labor, but also the cost of many other non-tradable inputs. But it fails to take into account other factors like infrastructural services. And if you look at that, we are not doing well in terms of the doing business. These are the country we have put in the sample, and you can see that Sub-Saharan Africa, okay, this is electrical outage, number of days of outage. And you can see how Sub-Saharan Africa is compared to other regions of the world. Okay, if you look at telephone connection, if you look at the number of days to clear imports, if you look at the paved roads, you have the same trends. And there are some figures we haven't shown. Those are figures about labor restrictions. In the formal sector in Africa, restrictions are bigger than even some European countries. We have the doing business, unfortunately, is no longer showing figures about labor restriction because they are undergoing several pressures from some NGOs, international organizations. But based from the data from the doing business, we have computed an index of labor regulation restrictiveness. And Senegal has exactly the same score as France, 0.5, which is restrictive. Our scale is from 0 to 1. Okay? The salaries, the wages are high in Senegal. I was telling Joachim yesterday that the number of days off in Senegal is 10 days superior to what we are observing in France, 20 days superior to what we are observing in China and in the US. To remove an employee is almost impossible. 99% of cases are won by employees against their employers. So you have all this combined to explain why the business environment is problematic in Senegal, in Francophone Africa, and in most of Africa. Now, should we still stick to this idea of going through manufacturing to jumpstart our development process? We have other alternatives. We have services. We have tourism. We have fishing. We have horticulture. This is 2014, I didn't add it. We have shown that horticulture right now in Senegal is booming, for example. We have many international companies that come and settle in the northern part of Senegal, close to the river. And they're doing quite well. Of course, we still have some quality issues, some standards issues to settle, but this is there. We have a lot of opportunities to go, and this is labor intensive also. Okay? And also, other traditional primary products. For example, the peanut sector. Okay? Confectionery groundnut has a huge demand. And in some African countries, we have huge potential. But this is completely being hindered by standards problems, standards issue. African countries fail to produce at the level of quality that we allow the products to be imported by Europe. That's why our import has dramatically decreased. So, we have other alternatives, and but these will need some reforms, some important reforms to take place. Okay? So this is our conclusion. What we believe is that we need a developmental state. In order to make things happen in the developing world, you cannot rely on the market. The government should intervene, and very strongly intervene, because the market very often doesn't function. We need to open up the market and to mix that with strong government intervention, but a wise intervention, avoiding errors of omission and errors of commission, to keep the formal sector wages competitive, which is not the case, to improve infrastructure and the business climates, and to focus on agriculture, horticulture, and also to keep trying on the manufacturing sector. Because what should be known and what should be noted is that most of our growth so far has been supported by the mining sector and other primary product. This is what I wanted to share as a result. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Ali, and colleagues. It's time for discussion. No, don't. To ask questions. Message was clear. In most African countries, the informal labor market is protected to such an extent that industry is uncompetitive at the cost of those in the informal sector who cannot get into the formal sector, where jobs are often distributed by, and you didn't say that, distributed by corruption. First question.
Yeah, thank you very much for this interesting, inspiring talk. My first question goes to this kind of old debate about the role of the state in developing economies. And of course, you showed the kind of success story of China and other South or Asian countries. I was wondering a bit, reading these policy conclusions, that there is need for the right mix of government interventions and market openings. Of course, everybody knows that in China, the mix is very different than for most African countries. There are some African countries who try to follow this kind of Beijing mix with heavily state interventions, where crucial decisions are being rather made in the ministries than by CEOs or by private parties. So where do you see your research in this direction, or what would you answer to this kind of mix of government interventions and market openings?
Mm-hmm. Okay, this is a very important question. What we have seen in the past in Africa is that government wanted to build what we call local bourgeoisie in French, a class of entrepreneurs, local entrepreneurs. But what they ended up doing was rather to build off a class of rent seekers. People who are continuously looking for governmental support. You have some businessmen who come to the government to receive money, who fail 5 years after, and who come back, keeping on going and going. So what we believe is that the government should now shift gears. We should, for example, give more incentive to small and medium enterprises. Usually big enterprises need huge amount of money, billions of CFA, while small enterprises need a small amount of money. But what we also need from the government, what we expect from them, is to clear the business environment. Because the business environment is such that it's very hard to do business in our countries, as I mentioned to you. The level of taxes are important. When you are in the formal sector, you have to pay up to 24 different taxes. Okay? That's why the number of formal businesses is only below 5% of the number of total businesses. Most of the businesses are informal. Most jobs are created by the informal sector because people evade the regulatory framework, the formal regulatory framework. So some actions are needed in that. To put taxes at a level that is deemed reasonable by businesses, to make some infrastructure services available, like electricity. People are, businesses are buying electricity sometimes 10 times beyond the world level. This is not sustainable. The cost of financing is high. So if you have all this combined, it's very, very difficult to have private business develop. And these are some public good elements we need. Government, strong government, to clear all these problems. The private sector cannot deal with those issues.
We have at least half a dozen questions. Let's take three, maybe you take note, and then we do another round. One, two, three.
Thank you, Professor Mbaye, for this interesting presentation. I have comments and one question. So my comments goes actually that when we compare China with Africa generally, we should definitely see also what kind of role capitalism or the variety of capitalism plays here, meaning that the money coming from China is literally different than the money that went earlier to China. It has a patience, let's say, the money that comes now to Africa. So we need to extend our horizon, how we look at this comparison. In my view, it's not a coincidence that Ethiopia and Tanzania are actually doing quite well compared to the other countries. And this has something to do that these two countries are involved in the extended Chinese thinking, how the economic should develop further. And this brings me to my question now. How do you see the role of special economic zones, which are now resurrecting on the African continent? Again, here Ethiopia is doing quite well in creating this environment for investment, especially from China. So do you think Senegal can follow that suit as well? Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you for your presentation. I have a couple of questions. One is, I was wondering whether the question is not so much whether Africa can compete with China, but rather whether Africa can compete with the countries where manufacturing might go if China sort of moves up the value chain or becomes less competitive in terms of wages. And I'm thinking in particular of Southeast Asia, countries like Thailand and Malaysia that are already producing for the Chinese markets, or low-wage countries like Cambodia and Laos. And the other question is relates to trade flows in the future. You were looking at China-Africa trade flows and the imbalance, but I don't know whether the important trade flows are not those to Europe and the US, so the strategy being that Africa bypasses China as a manufacturing hub and exports its processed manufactured products directly, rather than thinking of China as an export market.
One more question.
Three little ones. Ali, very nice presentation, thank you very much. You started off with this famous quote of Africa is growing economically and has sustained economic growth. I think 2 weeks ago there was a very depressive article in The Economist about the vanishing middle class in Africa, where contrary to previous reporting, they said yes, there is growth, but it doesn't trickle down. And in reality, in some of the poster boy countries where we have this kind of sustained economic growth, in reality, inequality is growing. What's your view on this? Second, you mentioned taxes. I think there's like two different scenarios. You have countries where theoretically you have these enormous tax load, but nobody pays it. And second, you have some countries that have improved their taxation systems. Kenya, very efficient, but then you pay your taxes and you see no investment. Third, this relationship to China. There was this very interesting book by Howard French on China, Africa's China's second continent, and he claims that if Africa wants to benefit from this relationship with China, it has to meet at IHA. If there is an inequality in the relationship, then Africa is not going to gain from this. I don't see any case in Africa where you kind of meet, where any African economy meets at equal with China. So how do you see this kind of benefiting from this relationship through capacity building or whatsoever between African countries and China? Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Over to you, Ali.
Okay,
and then we get another one, and okay. Maybe another.
Okay. Thank you very much. Your comments is well taken. But about special economic zones, I think that is very important. Africa has a long history and experience of special economic zones. But usually, these zones tended to be generalist. We wanted to host in the same zones different industries, textile, clothing, confectionery, many industries at the same time. While usually different industries need a special arrangement and special package in terms of incentives. So we believe that these special economic zones are relevant, but they should be modeled to accommodate African realities. I have done several studies for the Senegalese government. For example, NPU recommend special zones for mechanics or for carpenters. These guys are very small. They have no equipment, nothing. I have some pictures. While we could envisage a kind of zones where big equipments are available to them, and they would pay some fees to access these services, because these guys are literally working with their hands. We made a survey recently to the mechanics, and we asked the guy, okay, how much time does it take to you to detect a breakdown when a car is brought to you? He says sometime a day, sometime a week, because they're just proceeding by trial and errors. While with a small equipment, they could detect it right away, but they cannot afford it. We could find a kind of special arrangement. For example, cooperative firms could work within a zone that is being administered, and some common services would be charged to special users. And that is what we observe in Benin, but for the wrong sector. In Benin, we have a booming sector of used car imports and transportation. This sector makes up 10% of the GDP of Benin. The Benin import and re-export to Nigeria, to Burkina Faso, to all the landlocked countries, and to the bigger neighbor, Nigeria. And how it is happening? They have a park, they call it park in French, where you have several importers at the same time. Some services are provided to each users against some fees, and it works quite well. I would see the same arrangement in many sectors, like carpentry, like mechanics, like other sectors. Mm. So, yeah, I wouldn't think of the zone like we have done it before, or as it was done elsewhere. To me, instruments and tools need to be adapted to local reality. So I would see the zones adapted to better address the constraints small producers are facing. Because this is my point, small producers. I completely distrust bigger industries. These guys have the needed political connection to make their way through, but the real producers and those who create jobs are the small ones. So I'm apart from my research, I'm doing some work with them to try to connect them to partners and to make them thrive, because to me, this is the future of Africa. Now, the competition against China. Oh, is China our competitor, or is it
other Asian countries? Bangladesh or?
I think your point is right, because Bangladesh is doing quite well. And we should look at these countries. And China is no longer our counterpart in terms of competition. And I like their idea. We have invited Justin Lin, whom you know quite well. He used to be the vice president of the World Bank, and now he's an advisor to the Chinese government, and so he is involved with the businesses, Chinese businesses. And he made a very important presentation in Senegal, where he was explaining the new orientation of the Chinese government. He said, okay, we were sending our products to Europe, and now we want to come to do it here and to send it to Europe, but from Africa, from now on. So what I was discussing with the Europeans last time was, why didn't Europe think of that? Why do we need to import to Europe products from all the way to China, to Africa, and then to Europe? Yeah, I think we should try to develop synergies between both continents to see how we could profit from some resources that are important here, that are available here, which are capital is abundant here, technology is abundant here, training potentials. These could be put in parallel with what is what we have there in Africa, a big reservoir of labor force to try to build something in this special sector of manufacturing. Christian mentions that growth doesn't trickle down. It's true, because as I mentioned to you, growth is happening in capital intensive sector. Okay, mining is capital intensive. Even population, which in villages surrounding these activities, do not profit from that. So this is a problem. We need to make growth happen in sectors like agriculture, like manufacturing, like also tourism, other sectors like tourism, sectors which are intensive in labor.
The design of taxes, I totally agree with you. The system is completely silly. You have a system of where a tiny share of the population is shouldering the biggest share of revenue, tax revenue. In Senegal, what we call the grandes entreprises, they make up maybe 3% of the total number of businesses. They contribute for 90% of total taxes. The informal sector contributes to GDP at the level of 50% at least. And their contribution to tax income is as low as 3%. So it's completely silly. I would see a widening of the tax basis to make everybody contribute and to lower the pressure on some people. And apart from that, you have also the tax, what we call tax harassment. Once the government knows that you are a taxpayer, you undergo repeated audit inspections, okay? So I think this is a good way of designing a smart tax system, and you're definitely right.
Well, let's do one more round. Tobias, Charles, any other hand over there? Yeah, 1, 2, 3, 4, let's take those. Go ahead.
I just have a small question to the methodological approach that you use. Labor productivity obviously also depends on the capital of an economy. And I didn't see that capital is in considered in this approach. And if it's not, wouldn't its consideration change the results in favor of Africa?
Okay. Where is capital? What's in your production function? Not just this coefficient chart.
Yeah. Thanks for the presentation. What I saw was that the results were comparing China and some African countries. So what will happen if we aggregate the African countries and then do the comparison? What would the results be? Then my second part is, in terms of maybe trade also between African countries, we don't see much. African countries prefer to trade maybe with China or Europe or US, but maybe they have higher standards. What about we also considering the trade between African countries? Then we can use that one as the stepping stone to target the higher standards. Then my last part is in relation to your policy on focus on agriculture. How will this result generally be accepted in Africa? Because for instance, in Ghana now, agriculture is the least contributor to the GDP. So there are some level of differences in terms of the importance or the relative importance of the agriculture sector to the economy. So how much should we get a deal with agriculture?
Alicia, please. Thank you very much for the presentation. In your presentation, you did not talk much a lot about the role of economies of scale. China having a huge internal market, probably it had some role, positive role in its ascension, in its competitiveness. Other East Asian countries also have huge internal markets and could very quickly develop economies of scale. If you look at most African countries, you would see even if there are free trade agreements, markets are relatively small, often de facto fragmented. So do you think any possibility for achieving these economies of scale in African context as well? Or it's not needed, you would prefer rather go to compete by quality?
One more?
You said that the formal sector cannot compete. I was wondering, can the informal sector compete? Secondly, you promote here on the conclusion side of the market openness, also generally always in favor of this, but yeah, I wonder, shouldn't Africa try to prevent the export of raw products and have high taxes on this and instead focus on exporting manufactured products like China does, so that they would build up an industry around it?
You get one more. Please.
Yes, I also wonder a bit whether you are not comparing apples with pears a bit, yeah? Because you compare China with a bunch of African countries, yeah? And for instance, if you want to change the tax policy in China, well, you need one government to do that. If you want to do that in Africa, well, you need a number of governments to do that. So maybe some countries are faster than that, or they are, I don't know, maybe there's also some competition between countries. So do you see some African countries who are maybe more responsive to the actual situation, maybe some that will fall back?
Mm-hmm. let's leave it at that, and please choose if you want to address all five questions.
Okay, thank you very much. Tobias, we are focusing here on non-tradable inputs, because tradable inputs tend to have the same price worldwide. Price of tradable inputs tend to increase in some place, businesses can just import it from another place. But for non-tradable, it's more complicated. If labor is high in Germany, there's no way you can go and import labor from Senegal, for example. Most of yours in Senegal would be happy to come here and work, but they cannot do, because you have still these international arrangements that make it hard for labor to migrate from one country to another. Okay? Even you are having serious migration problems now. Okay? But I think this is the issue. We are just focusing on non-tradable. Okay, services or goods or inputs you cannot trade between from one country to another, because tradable inputs tend to have similar prices worldwide. You cannot make a difference based on this input. Why can't we aggregate Africa? Because Africa is heterogeneous. You have several countries and you have to fully account on that. You have several situations, okay, and it's very hard to aggregate them in only one entity, one single entity. Trade between African countries, is it happening? Yes. Most official data tend to show that Africa is not trading with Africa. It's not true. We have done a lot of research on cross-border trade, and we have shown that the magnitude of cross-border trade between African countries is huge. Okay? Nothing to do with what the official statistics show. Okay, and focus on agriculture. Is it relevant? Yeah, but of course it won't be like the traditional agriculture you know, where you have people doing everything with their hands. Okay, putting some technology into the agricultural sector and also addressing all the challenges the agricultural sector faces in Africa. You have many challenges, marketing challenges, access to inputs and financing challenges, many challenges that need to be addressed before agriculture can play in this kind of role. You have mentioned the problem of economy of scales. I don't believe that the internal markets in China make the difference. For a long time, China has relied to its internal markets. And for that long time, it has remained a very poor country. I think it started gaining momentum when it opened itself to the world market. So I think the issue is competition to the world market. Our model is about competition to the world market. Okay, and it still helps to have an internal market, but the world market is vaster and this should be the target, especially for this kind of items. Can the informal sector compete? Yeah, the informal sector is competing quite well. We have talked about the import of cars in Benin, and I can give you some figure. In 2014, last year, Benin imported 150,000 units of cars. And out of these, the formal sector only imported 1,500. It's less than 1%. There's the remainder is imported, was imported by the informal sector. I give you another figure, still in Benin. In Benin, most what we know here, the gas stations are very rare to see in Cotonou. Most people use
bio
bottles
bio.
To fill them. Yeah, bio.
Bio.
And the formal sector share in this sector is completely tiny.
Yeah, the informal sector is competitive, but the problem with the informal sector is that no foreign investment can come and settle in the informal sector. Okay? Because you're invisible. To be informal, you should be hidden. It's very hard to be hidden when you're a German or a Chinese or you get fine. So we have to look at what is happening in the informal sector. Okay. Last point. Mm-hmm. African country, some African countries response. Rwanda is doing well. Ethiopia is doing well. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That are the only example I really see. And Ethiopia is doing well because they have strong institutions. Kenya is doing well. Yeah. They are rare. But Africa is Africa. Once you have good policies that work somewhere, they tend to be duplicated elsewhere, replicated elsewhere. Yeah, so once we start implementing good policies, you see that it will be very fast.
Yeah. Well, Ali, let me make a couple of reflections, and maybe you want to reflect on those. Traditional change in development, structural change, relates to agriculture getting smaller, industry coming up, then services coming up, industry stagnating and declining as share of GDP. That cycle of change, of structural change, is quickly changing. So the time that industry comes up and comes down again as share in GDP has become much shorter. And the service sector, once glamorous in high labor productivity, has become a dumping ground of low productivity services. I think this is particularly severe in Africa, where this unproductive or low productivity service sector is now already capturing 40-50% of GDP in many countries. Now, what can these people do who are in this sector? They are increasingly well educated. If they cannot start and grow their business, and if they try to avoid excessive taxation or over-regulated labor markets for their employees, so squeezed from both sides, yeah? You hire people and cannot get rid of them, and you hire them out of a formal, non-peer-reviewing, quality-tested labor market, but through government pressure. What are the open options for them? I'm afraid it's mainly migration what's open to them. And out of this informal, increasingly well-skilled labor force in this low-productive, politically constrained service sector, I think the future migration waves from Africa to Europe will come. So if you don't get competitive with China, we will have them here, and maybe we make these people more competitive in the European labor market, but the adjustment problems may be significant. What's your reflection on this?
Yeah, very good points. We are not experiencing a structural transformation patterns as you have described. Usually it's how it works. Agriculture's share decreases, and then industry takes over and then loses ground, and then the service takes over. But not what is happening. In Africa, people are leaving agriculture to go to the informal sector. In Senegal, these are the current figures. Agriculture's contribution to GDP is down to 13%. Manufacturing is around 17%. So all the remainder is the service sector, is 6%. Okay? So it's a big challenge. But please don't believe that the informal sector is always a poor sector. We have documented in some other work what we call the big informal sector. You have people who are very rich in the farmers, in the informal sector. For example, we have done some surveys in Benin in July. One of the distributors of the informal distributors of gas, we asked him, okay, how much do you earn per month? Guess what? He was earning 300,000 CFA, which is roughly $500 to $600 per month. Okay? It's huge per month. Okay? Many civil servants in Africa don't earn that much. So in the informal sector, people are making deals. Okay? Those guys that are importing cars make good deals. Sometimes they're selling cars at the same price as new cars here. Okay? But now what is happening is that some sectors are overwhelming other sectors. For example, all the manufacturing sector in the informal sector is declining. Carpentry, mechanics, all those sectors are having trouble. The only sectors that are really booming are service sectors. Like three. People go to China, import, and come, put high margin. Okay? And of course, those who cannot make it just take the boats to come to Europe. Mm-hmm. I come from Dakar, which is the coastal part of Senegal. Normally, it's a part of the country which was well known because of the fishing activity. But now the fishing activity has problem. And most of the boats which used to be used for fishing are now used to ship migrants to Europe. So it's a big problem. I still believe that there are some synergies to be developed between Europe and Africa. I'd be really disappointed if you wait until Asian countries come to do it, because that's what they're intending to do, bringing the technology, bringing everything to process products and to ship everything to Europe. Mm-hmm. We don't need intermediary to do that. This is my personal thought.
Just a remark on your notion, on your relatively pessimistic notion that basically everything is going to lead to an outmigration.
Unless we get a serious reform.
Exactly. I think what we haven't mentioned is I believe in the near future we're going to see an enormous external pressure on various countries in Africa to get their act together in terms of policies, in terms of politics. I think one of the main, at least my personal experience, one of the main causes for all this economic mess is political mess.
Absolutely.
And as long as the political mess in sub-Saharan Africa is not sorted out, in one way or the other, the two success stories you mentioned, Rwanda and Ethiopia, they've sorted out their political mess in a very authoritarian and a very brutal way. Don't want to comment whether it's positive or negative, but they sorted it out. In most of the other countries, they haven't sorted it out, and they are just dragging down the economy.
I totally agree with your point. The problem we have is a governance problem. That's it.
Yes.
The technology is there, the leverages are there.
And the money is there.
And the money is there.
The money is there.
But it's a governance problem.
Yes.
And of course, the requirements of African populations in terms of governance are growing higher. I just give you the case of Guinea. The US sent some officials to the president of Guinea, Conde, to sell their idea of power Africa. The only question Conde asked them is, okay, can you give me power before election? The answer was no. And he replied very politely, so guy, I don't need you. And he went to see the Chinese. They brought electricity 3 months before elections, and he won the elections. Okay, so of course the requirements and the demands from the populations are growing, and this is a very good thing to me. Mm-hmm. Because the main problems are governance problems. We have done several case studies in many sectors, and the problems are the same. They all pertain to the governance problem. I totally agree with this point.
Well, that's a new way of interpreting what empowerment means.
we have the experience made recently with the case of Greece that even 250 billion euros don't buy you much of reform. I think when you are next time here, I'd like to hear you talk a bit more what incentives are needed in order to trigger meaningful reforms that are pro-employment, pro-poor. If we also look at countries in Europe, how rigid labor market reforms are, both business rent-seeking, trade unions lobbying, teachers' unions being very powerful, just to mention three major forces. Look at France, how slow reform processes are. And it's an irony, many of the tax regulations and labor market regulations, which Senegal and other countries in Africa have adopted, mm-hmm. are from here. Mm-hmm. So I think my message of today is we need to reform together, and maybe need your insights to join with European and international insights. Thank you again very much for your talk.
Thank you again for nice questions and also for inviting me.